The following feature presentation is part of the Skywalking Network. Long ago, in a galaxy far, far away, there exists a state of cosmic civil war. A brave alliance of underground freedom fighters has challenged the tyranny and oppression of the awesome Galactic Empire. This is their story. And that is how Marvel Comics began every one of their 107 issues of their original Star Wars comic series. I am Richard Woloski, and I want to welcome everyone back to Classic Marvel Star Wars Comics. I am here to take you through these classic stories, share memories of reading these comics as a kid, and to get you caught up with these characters and situations that every Star Wars fan must know. And because, as we noted, there are several connections and parallels to the current films and comics and novels, so we make a note of them in our FTOOM Fast Facts, so you won't miss when these come up. Now, everyone, here is my sweetie wife, Sarah, who is still 22 issues away from being born in 1981. And just to note, Chris Alexander had asked me, what issue will Sarah be born around? I looked it up. Sarah, you are born right before issue 48.
Oh.
And this is the Leia-themed issue, The Third Law.
Whoa! So we're not halfway there yet.
No.
We're almost halfway there.
Not for another couple of months.
Wow. Well, hey, hey, Skywalkers. Thank you for joining us on this podcast series where we break down each issue of the vintage Star Wars comic series that ran from 1977 through 1986. Now, I did not grow up reading these comics, and as we just stated, I wasn't even born for half of this series, so I'll be giving you my first-time reader 21st century opinions.
Now, let's get into it and catch everyone up with where we are in this two-part story arc. Now, in the last issue, Siege at Yavin, the Rebel base was being attacked by a squad of TIE fighters that seemed to come out of nowhere. Meanwhile, Princess Leia and Luke Skywalker arrive at the trading world, Centaurus, to trade in their ship since they've been spotted. As they leave the planet, they discover that a House of Tagge mining explorer ship is on its way to Yavin. Knowing the Tagge's ties with the Empire and fearing for the security of their rebel base, they follow them and soon discover that the mining ship is secretly transporting Imperial TIE fighters to Yavin for surprise attacks. Luke and Leia rush to alert the Alliance at Massassi base, but they are intercepted by an Imperial patrol. All right, now, Sarah, catch us up with this issue, Doom Mission.
All right, Luke and Leia are being attacked by two TIE fighters. Just as the situation appears hopeless, X-Wings arrive and destroy the two enemy fighters. Once Luke and Leia get back to the base, they inform General Dodonna about the TIE fighters cleverly entering the gaseous atmosphere of Yavin. Since Yavin's atmosphere is too thick for conventional signaling, they deduce that the House of Tagge and the Empire have developed some new signaling technology and set up a launch station within the gas giant. So Luke goes on a mission to retrieve one of the signaling units from a downed TIE fighter, and R2-D2 is critically damaged in the process. With no other choice, Luke sets out in a captured TIE fighter fitted with the new signaling unit through the atmosphere of Yavin to the House of Tagge launch station within the dangerous Yavin atmosphere. Now, will Luke survive this doom mission? Stay tuned to find out.
All right, now, Doom Mission. This issue was released May 22nd, 1979.
Wow.
And this issue was written by Archie Goodwin, Artwork by Carmine Infantino, Bob Wiacek, and Petra Goldberg. Cover art by Carmine Infantino and Bob Wiacek. And the consulting editor is Jim Shooter, who is very large at Marvel at this stage.
Okay.
All right, now let's go over this cover art.
Oh my goodness, here we go.
The only text here is Doom Mission, whereas in the last couple of issues, they had a little prelude that led up to the title of the issue. Here it just says Doom Mission.
Right, and then the big picture here, the cover art. Yeah. Which, should we describe this cover art here?
Yeah, take it away.
All right, so Luke, he still has his farm boy wardrobe here.
Which is always important.
Yes.
Because that's what they always mention in these last couple of issues.
Well, plus you know who he is because his face and hair really are He-Man. They really look nothing like Luke. Well, Luke here is standing over R2-D2.
And what's R2 doing right there? He's shrugging.
How is he shrugging?
Look at his shoulders. His arms are way above his head, his dome. Looks like he's shrugging like, I got blasted once again.
Oh.
Wah, wah.
Oh, interesting. Okay. Well, he's got a big hole blown in his side. Like, a big one. And, oh my gosh, I don't know who could have done such a thing, though.
Well, maybe it could be that TIE pilot in the background. The one who's hiding behind a spire.
Oh.
And he's the one aiming his blaster at Luke. So chances are, he's the one who shot R2.
Now, is this a black spire? Actually, it looks
like... No, this is a lavender spire.
Yes, a lavender spire.
Now, by the way, Luke looks like he's channeling Mark Hamill's General Hospital soap opera days with the overexpressive gestures.
Yes.
Oh my goodness. What's going to be inside? Where's the story going?
Mm-hmm. And also in the background of this cover art, we see a crashed TIE fighter ship.
Mm-hmm. Now, Sarah, give us your thoughts on the cover art.
Okay, well, like I said, He-Man, Luke, looks very perplexed, and he's probably horrified because a facehugger just jumped out of R2's cavity there.
Wait, am I missing something? where are you seeing this?
I'm not seeing a facehugger, but doesn't it look like the alien popped out of R2's side?
And who's inside of R2-D2? John Hurt. So yeah, it all ties in.
It does tie in.
Wait a minute, is that John Hurt in there or is that Kenny Baker? Hard to tell.
I don't know. Okay, well, and I do have to say though, props to the artist for R2, who is drawn spot on, although I guess you think he's shrugging, but to me he looked good.
Wait, what? Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
R2 looked good to me. Uh-huh. And it looks like they're in space, but without any space suits. And there's a stormtrooper behind him, but it's in red and blue. So is this a stormtrooper that's doing a Captain America or Captain Marvel stormtrooper mashup?
Back then, I don't know why, but right, a lot of the superheroes were in red spandex, like Batman would appear in red spandex. Why? I don't
know. What? Really?
Yeah.
Oh, Chris has a similar opinion here. The TIE pilot wearing a Rebellion pilot uniform? Yeah, it looks very...
Well, it's not orange. It's more
red. It's not orange, no. But yeah. Yeah.
Yeah, so red was the go-to color. But if he were in black or something else, he wouldn't stand out. You put him in red, he's going to stand out. And they're not thinking, well, you know what, in 41 years, will any podcast be dissecting this cover? No.
Of course they will.
They were so wrong. These covers always confused me. Are they on a moon surface? They are so close to the star field behind them. I never really knew where they were. And why is Luke not wearing a space suit like the TIE pilot behind him? Mm-hmm. So I didn't know where exactly this was taking place. Other than that, I did like this cover as a kid. I could see the drama here and that Luke's little R2 friend had been destroyed, knowing quite well they were overplaying the scene, just like those other covers where it looks like Han Solo was being shot.
Oh.
And the colors all play really well too, and even though the close-by starfields confused me as a kid, I did like the look of it.
Okay, cool. We got some comments here from Facebook and YouTube. Megan was also thinking that was a black spire back by the mm-hmm. stormtrooper. So let's go into some of the art here. So I feel like the colors are an interesting choice they used on this cover, but it totally draws me in. You know, it's an interesting choice for Star Wars, but I feel it really draws the eye. You've got this foreground of hot pink and orange rock that's cradling R2 up here, and then a mid-ground of light pink and lavender, And these are all set off by the deep black space and a lime green moon up there for good measure. So, but despite all these colors, your eye goes right to Luke and R2 in the center, which are mostly white or very light blue. And the Doom mission in big letters at the bottom, well, it almost gets a little lost to me. But I feel like this whole cover, you know, it's marketed to kids, and they are more focused on the pictures, right, Richard?
Oh, of course we are.
Yeah, so
that's
I guess...
all we see. But if you didn't put the Doom mission way down below, where else would you put it?
Exactly. That's what I... Yeah. So I think the Doom mission down there is fine. I don't think it adds or loses anything.
Mm-hmm. All right, now let's read a couple of these Facebook comments, because as always, we put out the cover art in our Facebook group and let people just go crazy with the comments. All right, Brian Babcock says, I always thought the inside of R2 was a little man. Yeah, if you look really hard, you can see Kenny Baker, but once again, that might be John Hurt. Very hard to tell.
Oh, I know. Courtney Turkell was fooled by this pilot uniform here. Geez, looks like someone on the rebel side is going to turn on Luke. And poor R2.
All right, Jennifer Cole says, is that really Luke's shocked face? And did he karate chop poor R2? Looks like he's going to be giving him a Danielson karate chop. And what could possibly have caused this mayhem? Let's find out. Jennifer Cole should be writing voiceovers.
Exactly. Rex Gordon says, as a kid, I figured out that the guy with the gun was colored incorrectly, as the TIE fighter implies it's an Imperial shooting at Luke.
I never got that it was a rebel back there.
Yeah.
Because of the helmet. This looks like the old Ralph McQuarrie style helmets.
Okay, yeah. And Rex goes on to say, I also knew R2 would be okay because he was blown up in the movie and survived. Mm-hmm. So not the greatest cover, but classic Marvel Star Wars still rocks.
All right. Travis Sulzer says, Karate Luke. There you go. With real karate chop action. New action figure from the Star Wars universe.
Nice.
Eric Warren says, Luke performs an emergency appendectomy on R2. Carlos Munoz says, as a kid, I couldn't figure out if that purple goop on R2 was coming out of him or something trying to crawl into him.
And either option terrified me.
Yuck, Infantino. Yuck.
Nice, Carlos.
And then Rex Gordon piggybacks off of that by saying, Infantino is the Dolly of Star Wars.
Nice. Denise says, the soul of R2-D2 leaving his body. He will have an out-of-robo-body experience. So R2's soul is purple.
No, I get it. It's white there.
Oh, but what's the purple stuff? Then?
That's just the molten metal.
Okay.
Chris Alexander says, what is the soft, squishy, pinkish stuff R2 is laying in? It looks like Jell-O. It looks like R2 was blown back so hard, he caused a little imprint on the rock.
Oh, I know.
It's like when Bugs Bunny gets thrown up against a wall.
Yeah.
You see his imprint?
Oh, yeah.
Poor R2.
Wow. So funny.
All right, Sarah. Now, let's move on and give your initial thoughts on this issue 26, Doom Mission. I'm fighting the urge to say Doom Patrol.
I know. All right, so I really liked this issue. And it has the story... had peaks and valleys like a good mountain range. And I really, you know, that's like when you know a story is really good, when you have like those moments of calm, followed by moments of action, followed by moments of calm. And I thought it was really great. They even had like moments of meditation in there. And throughout the issue, you had characters on their outward missions, like Luke and Leia are returning from a mission. And then Luke goes off on another mission and all these things. But while that's happening, all these outward missions, you still have some character building missions within themselves. You know, like Luke grows. I think Leia has this moment of the soft moment of strength. It's really, I don't know. I really loved this issue. It was very well thought out, very well written.
Okay, nice. I was very interested to see what they could do with a 2-part story arc after coming off of a 5-part story arc with the wheel. 2 parts. Doesn't leave much for development, but let's find out. And I love that we have some smaller characters from Star Wars, like Dodonna and General Willard. And we are back on Yavin that we hardly got to see in Star Wars. The story is solid, and the twist with the Imperial base somewhere on Yavin is very unique.
Yeah, definitely.
Plus, we have a new antagonist whose life goal is to defeat Darth Vader because of a personal vendetta. And this is the second character right after Valance the Hunter, who's had it in for Darth Vader.
Okay, wow. All right, so let's go to this issue here, and let's see the first page.
Look at that's a splash page.
Doom mission, very, very big.
All right, now let's get into the story. Two TIE fighters are pummeling Luke and Leia's ship as they are attempting to get back to the Yavin base. Narration reads, "Homecoming! A not-so-funny thing happened to Luke, Leia, and the droids returning to the Yavin system." They were going for a joke there that just didn't
like, did they just come back from the Broadway theater?
That's the funny thing happened on the way back.
On the forum. On the way to the forum, yeah.
And it says here, they discovered Imperial Raiders in Alliance territory. Since when are they Imperial Raiders?
Yeah. Aren't smugglers Raiders? Not Imperials.
And Tuscans.
Yeah.
I think they just wanted a new word to throw in there for the Empire.
All right. I don't buy it.
No, me neither. That's why I made note of it. All right, Luke says, "It's no use. Our communicator's out. One engine's shields are failing. Even the Force couldn't save us now."
Ugh.
All right, and R2 is in back, and he's trying to extinguish a fire in the ship. And 3PO says, "Why haven't I said anything about being doomed as I usually do? Because Master Luke already seems to be saying it, and somehow it sounds far more convincing from him." That wasn't too bad.
That was cute, sweetie. I liked it.
On a scale of 1 to 10, it was about a 3.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
Okay.
I've improved.
Even though you didn't quite, sweetie, I feel that the writers really captured the voice of 3PO and R2 here. I thought it was great writing in this issue.
Why? I did my best, okay? I did my best. Chris Alexander just popped on and said, "The ties in this issue look like they were drawn by someone who only had a third-hand spoken description to work with."
Oh.
Yeah. But, you know, like we were saying the last time, they look like they're based on the Kenner toys.
Yeah, exactly.
Oh. Now, Leia is in the gunner seat blasting away at the pursuing TIE fighters. Luke asks, "How did a girl from a planet with no weapons get so good with them?" And Leia says,
"Promise to get us out of here, Flyboy, and I'll tell you all about it."
Now, that should be a name only reserved for Han Solo.
Yeah.
Luke is not a fly boy.
He's not a fly. He flies.
He flies, and
he's a boy.
Yeah, maybe if she knew about his T-16 days.
Yeah.
But she's already calling Han Flyboy. Let's just keep it there.
Okay.
All right, now, their ship takes another bad hit, and their fate doesn't look good until they are saved by a squad of X-Wing fighters. One of the TIEs explodes, but the other goes crashing down to Yavin's moon. Luke and Leia's ship has landed at the Rebel base, but is ablaze with flames.
What?
Several troops are working very hard to put the burning ship out. And in the foreground, we see General Dodonna is greeting Luke, Leia, and the droids, who don't seem to notice the burning ship in the background. This bottom frame is hilariously funny.
Oh my god.
They're like feet away from this blazing ship. Rebel squads are running to try to put it out. Luke's got his hands on his hips.
Uh-huh.
R2 and 3PO don't seem to notice either.
R2 and 3PO are the cardboard cutouts that you see. They look very flat.
Yeah, no one's responding to this huge, huge fire bomb behind them.
Yeah.
And it's a ship, so it might blow.
Okay, now when a ship is gonna land, like, why land right by this ancient temple ruins? You know, like, why land a little bit further away so it's not gonna...
Like in Revenge of the Sith, they were trying to bring the ship down to the Coruscant landing strip. Oh. So it was either that or go crashing into the trees, and you don't know what's going to be in there.
All right.
Now, Dodonna is telling Leia that they just about gave up on them since communication has been spotty.
Mm-hmm.
So he was going to give up on a princess/senator and the boy who just blew up the Death Star because communication was spotty.
Yeah. Sounds about right.
If we were to do that, we would never do another Zoom recording in our life. How did this guy make general?
I don't know.
Now, Leia breaks in and tells him that she has news, and it ain't good.
Doesn't she even say ain't?
No, she says isn't.
Oh, okay.
I just threw an ain't because it sounded funny.
It does.
All right. The Donna says, not much has been really good with the daily raids happening and the stepped up Imperial patrols, and they have no idea where the Empire is hiding their base. And at this point, Leia gets out her slide projector, or as she calls it, a photo recorder.
Yes. Oh my gosh.
So for those of you who went to the school in the 70s or 80s when they would reel in that slide projector, that's what we're looking at right here. Oh, you can see them right there.
So she brings out her photo recorder and shows Dodonna what she and Luke found out about the Tagge exploring ship that has been bringing in the TIE fighters to Yavin. It's like, where are all these TIEs coming from? And right here in high def, she shows them panels from last month's Star Wars Marvel comic.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Who's to say they don't have a newsstand or a spinner rack on Yavin? So she's literally showing them panels from issue number 25, Siege at Yavin.
Yes.
All right. Now, Luke is optimistic about finding the Empire's base. Just then, it dawns on him that one of the TIEs from earlier didn't explode, but crashed on another one of Yavin's moons.
Oh, nice.
That ship might still have an intact signal unit, which they've been using to navigate around the heavy atmospheric gases, which shut down other systems and other ships. So, hey, I know where I can go and find one of these.
Okay.
So Luke sprints away to his X or Y wing?
Hard yeah, to here tell. He's sprinting away.
You see
next scene.
The red stripe gives it away.
This is an X wing.
To make it look like an X wing.
Yes.
But as we see, we're being fooled.
Yeah, later on, they call it a Y wing.
Mm-hmm.
All right, go
All
ahead.
All right, so Luke jumps in his Y wing and he sees the downed TIE on Yavin's moon and goes to explore with R2. However, we see the hiding TIE pilot who is holding a remote destructive unit.
Oh, right
his
there.
Fingers on the button. All he's got to do is press boom. That's what it says right
oh,
there.
Yeah.
It's the red button that says boom. And Luke and
looks
the
like
ship.
A yellow button.
Okay, shh. It's red button.
Okay,
I see everything as a red button.
Okay.
All he's got to do is press that button.
Yeah.
But he didn't. And his inner monologue says that he wishes that his own outfit would have come looking for him before these rebels. Those rebel scum. Now, once again, the artist has taken a
Liberty?
Cue from Ralph McQuarrie's paintings. This is from one of Ralph McQuarrie's Star Wars art concepts where
okay.
you have a TIE pilot in a TIE fighter. You see over his shoulder as he's blasting away rebel ships.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, cool.
Yeah, very, 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 very subtle Ralph McQuarrie inspiration.
Okay, nice.
Mm-hmm. Now, Luke, who is wearing an outer space breath mask, finally, not like the cover, and R2 go fishing around the TIE cockpit when R2 spots a detonator, which is about to go off and rips out the wiring.
Look at this. Fru-roop, fru-doop. So cute.
Just then, the TIE pilot jumps out and blasts R2, who shrieks. See, I can do R2 just as well as 3PO.
That sounds great.
Luke blasts the pilot and takes him out.
All right, before we leave this page, this is like a really pretty piece of art, this comic book page. You've got this Ralph McQuarrie-esque shot.
Mm-hmm.
You've got another shot from the cockpit. The
cockpit point of view.
Yeah, the cockpit point of view looking at Luke and R2 walking up to it, and it's a shattered cockpit, so it just looks amazing. And then from R2's like frantic, like trying to undo the wiring, like it's a really good piece of art.
It is. And Chris Alexander says, and check out what Luke's wearing now. Look what he's wearing on the moon. How in the did he get changed in the cockpit? So when he jumped in the cockpit, he was wearing his Tatooine farm boy outfit.
Oh.
Now he's wearing his X-Wing pilot outfit.
Right here.
Well, there's a dressing room. You go downstairs and take the third door to the right. That leads to another dressing room on a further deck below.
Oh, I see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right. Even Colossus Rex says, cool artwork.
Nice.
All right. Luke gets back to the Massassi base. Leia says,
Luke, we were getting frantic about you.
I hope Luke caught that, too.
I bet he did.
Mm-hmm. Luke says, Luke, do not kiss her right now. Do not kiss her. Luke says he got the gadget he went looking for, which took him some time since he had to do it by himself without R2's help. Just then, a mechanical arm lifts R2 out of the Y-Wing.
And now it's a Y-Wing.
Mm-hmm. He looks worse than he did on the cover, and half his body is torn to shreds. It's not even torn, it's like melted off of his body.
Yeah, it's super weird.
Yeah. Mm. A deck officer tells...
Deck officer!
tells Luke, a deck officer, tells Luke that they are hitting rock bottom with parts, and there are a lot of R2 units who could really use this R2's parts.
Oh! What?
Oh, but then Luke freaks out and jabs the man in the throat.
Watch this.
Oh, show everybody. Look at that.
Oh, my God.
Oh, that does not feel good. He's literally plunging his forefinger right in the guy's throat.
Adam's apple right there. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So he and 3PO take R2 away.
Yeah.
And even Leia can't look at this guy.
Oh, yeah. No, she's looking down, right? Mm-hmm. It's kind of odd.
Her eyes are closed. She can't even look at this guy with a curly Q beard.
Yeah.
This guy spends more time on his facial hair than I do on my hair in 2020.
Look at this. Woo. Mm-hmm. That's really fun.
All right. Now, Luke, he's feeling guilty about R2. He hastily took off to retrieve the Imperial gadget because he was just trying to make up for not completing his original mission. Are you confused? Well, you should be, because this original mission took place in issue 8.
What?
8 for Aduba 3, and this is where he went out looking for a new rebel base, and I'm sure he's thinking, if I had found one, then maybe R2 wouldn't have been shot.
Okay. Hmm.
Or maybe if he had found one on another planet, maybe something worse would have happened to R2.
Yeah.
Just then, Dodonna comes running over to them. He needs to send Luke on a mission where he will doubtfully return. And Sarah, what kind of mission is this?
A doom mission!
Mission, mission, mission.
Okay, look at this. Another beautiful panel here. I really love this. We'll talk about this later, but just check it out, everyone.
That moon is so close that if Chewbacca were standing nearby, he'd be like, not again.
That's not a moon, though. That's Yavin. They are on a moon.
They're on a moon, but there's four moons of Yavin.
Right. No, but that's Yavin right there. And they're on a moon, on a temple on a moon. But yeah, it's really cool because it's like the temple and Luke are silhouetted and he's like looking out, you know, he has his back turned toward us.
It's very
looking out at the Yavin.
It's very A New Hope, where he's looking out at the Tatooine twin suns.
And it's night, and you can almost hear the cicadas or all those, you know, the night noises. Mm-hmm. And Leia's joining him up there. It's really cool. Love this panel.
All right, so now before we find out what happens with Luke on this doom mission, we have to cut to a commercial break.
Oh, okay.
All right, now... Sadly, there is not a Marvel Hostess ad in this issue, which made me really, really, really sad.
Oh, no.
I love those so much. But there is a Superman ad. Wait a minute. Superman? That's DC. This is Marvel. How can that happen? How can they coexist? But in this ad, you can buy kryptonite rocks.
What?
Okay, now I see the big picture here.
Oh,
Marvel's trying to do away with Superman.
Marvel allowed this particular one because it's kryptonite.
Yep. All right, now let's go ahead and read the text here in this ad. It's terrific. It's fantastic. It's kryptonastic.
Wow.
And that didn't really work. That's what it says here, though. Attention, friends of Superman. Do you really want to be a friend of Superman? Well, now you can by owning a kryptonite rock. Wait a minute.
Wait, a friend of Superman?
Why would you be a friend? Well, hold on. They go on to explain how you can become a friend of Superman if you own a piece of kryptonite rock.
Okay, so here we go. A short while ago, we, the good guys, spotted a very large piece of kryptonite rock about to smash into the earth. We immediately sent out a search party to find and bring back the kryptonite rock before it fell into the wrong hands.
Wouldn't it be very hard for the wrong hands to obtain this kryptonite rock now? All right, now, the ad continues. We now have the kryptonite rock broken into a million pieces and are making it available to all of Superman's friends for safekeeping. So once again, what would stop Lex Luthor?
I guess they assume that only good guys read comics?
Yeah, all right.
Yeah?
Okay. Okay. Well, we can go there.
All right. Kryptonite rocks are blue-green in color, and they glow in the dark. Kryptonite rocks can be yours for only $250 plus a shipping charge.
Not $250, but $2.50.
Yes.
Now, there is an asterisk here, just to make sure that we're all on the same page. The above story is only fictional and is in no way to be confused with actual fact.
Oh my gosh.
I'm so glad they put that, because I was about to send in hundreds of dollars to buy these kryptonite rocks so they wouldn't fall into the wrong hands.
Well, I want to know where the link to the website is so we can buy these kryptonite rocks.
Scroll down. Right there, it says...
Send check or money order?
Hashtag,
what is that?
We won't have a social media handle for another 40 years.
Wow.
But if anyone out there wants to buy a kryptonite rock, well, just send in $2.50 plus a shipping charge to Mail Away Department 3, 150 East 58th Street, New York, New York, 10022.
All right, so Rex Racer says, kryptonite rocks were a ripoff. They were really just regular rocks painted green. Now, Rex, did you own one of these kryptonite rocks?
Oh, Rex.
Oh, my gosh.
Let us know.
Yes. Oh, here, Courtney. Send a check. What is that? Yeah, right?
I think when you put something in your cart online, you check it off. Is that what they're talking about?
The last time I sent a check, I think, was like 99. Like, ridiculous. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, wow. Now, go back to those Marvel Hostess ads.
Uh-huh.
They were in brilliant colors.
Oh, yeah.
And check out the color in this Superman ad.
What color?
Yeah. For you people not watching on StreamYard right now, you're really missing out on these deep blacks and these deep whites.
But if you do want to see this, the classic Marvel Star Wars Comics live episode will be available to watch on YouTube, the uncut version. So, yeah, you can head there and look for, like, live streams on YouTube. Oh my gosh.
It'd be worth dropping $2.50 plus a small shipping charge just to see where it goes.
Oh, yeah. No kidding.
They get the address right there.
Yeah?
Tempting. If I have time later on, I might just do that with a photocopy of this because I don't want to cut it out.
Mark
says, my brother had one of these rocks.
Whoa!
Mark, you must post this on our Facebook
group.
Does
he still have a picture of it, or does he still have the rock? We want to see it. I got a rock.
I got a kryptonite rock.
All right. Now, back to our story.
Okay, back to our story. The mission Luke must embark on is to fly a stolen TIE fighter that is loaded up with proton charges and fly it into the storm corridor to the hidden base and take it out.
Uh-oh.
Mm-hmm.
But once he takes it out...
Oh, that's why it's a... What do you call it?
Doom mission.
There you go. Luke flies the TIE fighter out of the base into the destiny that awaits young Skywalker.
Leia can't bear to watch, as Luke has taken on a mission where he probably won't return. She has found herself a spot, and the narration reads, what kind of example would she be if a princess, senator, leader, and symbol of the Rebel Alliance showed that she cries?
She'd show them that she's got emotions and feelings.
Well, I literally like this quiet moment here.
Yes.
Because, I mean, as a woman, I know whenever I cry, Richard, you're always like, oh, how can I help? How can I fix it? But for me, sometimes you just need a good cry and it's like cathartic. So, you know, Leia was having her moment of emotion and then she can show a brave face to the world after she has a good cry.
She needs Han Solo where she can say, hold me.
Oh.
Now, in other chambers, other vigils are kept. An emotional 3PO is yelling at R2 for getting himself blown up. Can't you even bleep R2? Call me a carbon-scored crybaby. He then says, I won't be able to bear it if you're turned into spare parts. Now, check it out.
Okay.
There is a typo.
Oh!
They spelled bear in Barrett.
Mm-hmm.
As B-E-A-R.
Whoops.
When it should be B-A-R-E. And how do I know this? I looked it up.
Oh my gosh.
Because I looked at that and said, that doesn't look right.
Mm-mm.
I won't be able to bear it if you're turned into spare parts. Yeah, so there you go. It's B-A-R-E.
Huh. Okay.
I don't want to be that guy to call that out, but you know what?
Why don't you write in?
You know what? And I'm sure someone will.
Uh-huh.
You should see the little things people comment
on.
Which we'll find out soon enough.
All right. What happens next?
All right, cut to Luke and the TIE fighter, which dive bombs into a gas whirlwind, which is how the other TIEs secretly got to their base on Yavin. And Luke's inner monologue is telling the reader what is going on. Luke's TIE ship was just modified with the high-frequency transmitter that other Imperial ships will receive.
Wow.
So this is all going on in his head. He's got to narrate everything.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Smash cut to a splash page that reveals a giant turbine engine, which is the thing that is stirring up the gaseous whirlwind so the TIEs can be hidden. And Luke also sees the Tag Explorer ship moored to the side.
How cool is this splash page, you guys? This is amazing. It's all purpley, lavender, pinky with the winds. And then the ship, the turbine is this light blue. And the Tag ship is, what is this on the side? Would that be yellow, green, like a limey yellow? Something?
No, that's more of a lime green.
Okay, it's really, really neat.
And now, inside the turbine engine, Baron Tagge is training with his lightsaber against a few remotes. His aide, Shanks, alerts him to the lone TIE ship that is incoming. And the Baron just thinks it's one of the patrols from earlier, but then he says he felt certain rebels were onto them. So now, Baron, which one is it? You're saying two different things here. Is it a patrol ship? Or is it a rebel?
Right.
Says it all in one thought bubble, which really confuses me. Now, let's pause here for a Baron Tagge story refresher.
Oh, okay, good. Oh, please.
Okay, now.
Because I was kind of confused when it got to this part.
Okay, now, Baron Tagge is attacking the rebel base with the TIE fighters that he's sneaking in the mining explorer ship, with hopes that he'll be the one to crush the rebellion and win the Emperor's favor, and not that blasted wizard Darth Vader.
Okay.
And he'll also have his sweet revenge on Vader, since it was he who cursed the Baron of a lifetime of cyber vision with a blow by Vader's lightsaber.
Okay. Do we ever know why he used his lightsaber against Baron Tagge?
It was in the last issue. It was just a struggle. And okay. I think just because Tagge was being too big for his britches.
Okay.
And trying to be in favor with the Emperor over Vader. And Vader said,
Right, right.
And slashed him with his lightsaber.
Okay.
Couldn't kill him because he's not Imperial, but his family funds the Imperial Star Destroyers.
Oh.
So Vader can't necessarily kill him off because that would be very, very, very bad.
Very bad. And and also he's not a Sith.
No,
Rex Racer.
No.
He just owns a lightsaber. It's kind of like
Don Juan Quixote.
Or Grievous.
Or
right?
Grievous.
General Grievous.
Yeah, they just pick up lightsabers anywhere and
they
everywhere.
They kind of learn how to use them. They don't use the Force, but they...
Maybe they went back to the Jedi Temple and said, hey, you know what? No one's using this lightsaber. Well, maybe I'll add this to my collection.
Exactly.
All right, but question is now, why doesn't Tagge just bring in enough TIE fighters for one big attack on the Massassi base? But he brings in like two at a time.
Yeah, I don't understand.
Me neither. All right, so that's his backstory. So now we're all caught up with his motivations.
Okay, cool.
All right, just then, their conversation is halted when Luke starts to attack the turbine engine.
Whoa. Baron, what?
See, now look, he's even wearing blue and red spandex.
Yeah, it's
a red spandex bodysuit and like Batman blue boots and gloves.
Yeah, he almost looks like the reverse of a Superman without the S.
All right, Luke is blasting at the turbine engine with the heavy-duty charges, which causes a lot of destruction until finally the turbine engine explodes. And a big ball of white, pink, and lavender light. Boom!
Oh my gosh, look at that.
Yeah, but now Luke's problems truly begin. Because now he's alone, fighting to keep his ship together that was hastily refitted for the mission's needs. Without any guiding instruments, he's just hurtling through space.
Oof.
And as he's hurtling, he reminds himself that he can draw upon the Force to guide him, but he reminds himself and the reader of every time he's used the Force in the past, either accidentally or on purpose. He's got like a laundry list here. But now he trusts in what Ben taught him. He has to believe in the Force. All right. Unlike other times. Now, Luke, actions speak louder than words.
Uh-huh.
So get moving. get moving, because this was the Doom mission in the Doom mission, because as this thing is blowing up, it's taking everything in its path with it. So, Luke, get out.
Yeah, so he's using the Force to help guide him. We're not sure how, but there's a lot of cool panels of him upside down and sideways. And
do you know how he taps into the Force?
How?
He believes.
He does. He believes.
He believes, and he succeeds.
Oh, nice.
Now, he is out of the mess and headed back to the Massassi base on Yavin.
Ooh.
Yavin 4, to be exact.
Meanwhile, that base had exploded. So you think, we just saw General Tagge and his dude, and you think they're dead.
Yeah. Not General Tagge.
Oh.
Baron Tagge.
Baron Tagge, yes.
Yes, yes. Now, the Baron Tagge and Shanks, I know you were worried about Shanks.
Oh, yes.
But guess what?
What?
They live.
What?
Mm-hmm.
How does this happen?
They had also escaped and followed Luke to safety. And now the Baron is pulling a Kylo Ren and angrily destroying everything and anything in his path with his lightsaber.
Oh, yeah, look at that.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
And he says, he did the impossible, Shanks, and ruined my chances of showing up Darth Vader in the process. I added that. Someday I'll learn his secret.
Wow.
What secret are you talking about? And someday I'll do to Luke Skywalker worse than the Sith Lord did to me.
Wow. Wielding his orangish lightsaber.
Yeah, now it's orange.
They should make orange lightsabers.
And now they end on a cliffhanger that won't be picked up for another few more issues. Next issue, the attempt to restore R2-D2 may be doomed by the return of the Hunter.
Oh, whoa, look at that.
Mm-hmm. Now the Hunter, that's Valance. And as Marvel Star Wars readers know, in today's comic series,
okay,
Valance is back. They're bringing this character back in a couple of series.
Wow.
Which makes me really, really excited.
Wow.
This is like the one through character from the original Star Wars comic series.
Oh my gosh.
Because he came back for that 108th issue last year.
Okay.
So they just kept him going. We got a good character here. He's like a force against Darth Vader. The two of them are always going at it.
Okay.
So this is a great character. And there's one series called Target Vader. You got to read this. So good.
Target Vader?
Target Vader.
Is it set in Target?
No. Kmart. Well, I see where you're going there.
Okay, good.
Chris Alexander says, how in the does Tagge know Luke was flying the TIE fighter?
Oh.
That is a great question.
Huh.
Yeah, they kind of just jumped there.
Yeah.
Well, you know what? After 41 years, I never noticed that.
Okay.
Leave it to Chris.
So Kai has been reading the current Bounty Hunter series. Oh.
Oh, yeah.
Nice. Have you?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, they're now on the Marvel Unlimited app.
Yeah. Okay, nice. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've been actually catching up with Ms. Marvel and Captain Marvel on the Marvel Unlimited app, but cool.
Mm-hmm. All right, now, Sarah, give us your last thoughts on this issue.
Okay, so again, I really, really liked this issue a lot. And as I was reading it, and I was trying to figure out why, and as I was reading it, I noticed that there was a lot of dialogue, both like narration and character voices. And for me, it was almost easier to read because my brain kind of skipped over the pictures and just flowed with the words, and it was a really good story with all the words. So that's why I think I really enjoyed reading it more than some, because for me, it takes me like two sides of my brain to read. Okay, read the words. Okay, now look at the panels. Okay, read the words. Now look at the panels. Like, there's a stop start for me. So this one just, it flowed.
Okay.
And also, things I really loved were that it began in the middle of action, like any good action film. You're like right in the middle of this Luke and Leia battle with some TIE fighters. And then you have quiet moments as well. So Leia has her moment to cry, but finds her strength within. So I thought that was a great carry-on moment. And Luke further develops and uses his Force powers in this issue, both within meditation. We didn't talk about it, but there are some moments of meditation right before he leaves for his Doom mission. And then also he taps into that Force, exiting the gaseous Yavin. So I thought that was great. And then everyone loves a good fake out. And I totally thought, not General, Baron Tagge was dead, but he comes back at the end to set up what I thought was the next issue. But it's not the next issue.
I wonder if this Tagge sounds or has the gravelly voice of General Tagge in Star Wars.
Oh, well, you know what? He does in your head, then he does.
You know, next time I'll have to read it in that gravelly voice. Until this battle station is
fully operational, we are vulnerable. The Rebel Alliance is too well equipped.
Nice. That was pretty good.
Okay. Just dawned on me now. I'll have to go back and revoice some things. All right. For me, this was a fun issue. We didn't get much from just a two-part story arc. There was much more that could have been developed, like Baron's revenge strategy on Vader and the Rebels doing more to find out where these ties are coming from. There could have been a whole issue devoted to a ground assault where the Imperials are invading the Massassi base. And I wish they hadn't left on a cliffhanger, since we aren't coming back to this story in the next issue, or even the issue after that. So I'm not sure why they did this, but it was fun. It was short. Five-issue story arcs are a little bit long. Two are a little bit short.
Right.
Even for kids. Kids would want to see a little bit more.
I honestly thought I liked the two-part issue. You set up some stuff, and then you tie it up at the second issue. It's like, one, two, done. I liked it.
Okay. To each is their own. All right, now let's move into our favorites. So, Sarah, what is your favorite line of dialogue?
Okay, so on page 11, Luke has just left on his seemingly suicide mission to destroy the base within Yavin, and Leia is inside those ancient runes all alone. It's kind of this solitary shot, and the narration reads, which we read before, "What kind of example would she be if a princess, senator, leader, and symbol of the Rebel Alliance showed that she cries?" And I thought that was just a real moment of emotion, and I really liked that, and it's not something you get a lot in comics, these quiet moments. Mm-hmm. So it was a moment of resilience, and I loved it.
Okay.
What about you?
Now, for me, mine comes on page 3, where Luke says, "This bucket of bolts just took one more hit than even Jorman Thode would claim it could handle." And I like the fact that they're referring to a small character,
right,
from the last issue. And this is the used car salesman character that sold them this ship.
Yeah.
So the fact that they even went there and brought him back. So that deserves my favorite line of the series, of this issue.
All right. Well, what is your favorite panel then?
Should I steal yours? Because that was my favorite panel until I saw that you also thought it was your favorite panel.
We should tell them which panel it is.
Okay, you know what? Since I set it up, okay, you go ahead and you reveal your favorite panel.
Okay, my favorite panel is Luke on top of the Massassi runes, staring out into space at night. And it's just so, I don't know, there's such a poetry to this scene. I love it. I can almost hear the crickets, the nighttime sounds, and the tone of this image is just beautiful. So it reminds me of Return of the Jedi and the night in the Ewok village when Luke tells Leia that she's his sister. And that's why I like it. And Luke is meditating, trying to become more attuned to the Force.
A very beautiful panel.
So you liked this one too?
I did like this one.
Okay.
And I saw that you liked it, so I had to pick another one.
Okay,
and
good.
For mine, it comes on page 11, where you see the TIE fighter flying out of the Massassi base.
Okay, is it this one right
here? This one right there, yeah. Because you don't think you'd ever see a TIE fighter flying out of a Rebel base. And you have the engine thrust as the TIE fighter is flying out, but it looks like the TIE fighter is shooting into the base.
It really does. Yeah, I get confused when things are shooting at or, you know, zooming from things.
I guess you could tell because TIE fighter blasts are green.
Yeah.
But in the moment, at least have like wind lines coming off the wings.
Right.
That would show that this is the TIE fighter blasting away.
Right. Now, did you have something else here, Richard?
Yeah. This scene right over here, if you scroll down on page 11.
Okay.
This is where Leia is trying to find her alone time.
Yeah.
And she's thinking about Luke's doom mission. So you have her in a spotlight.
Oh, yeah.
And her hand up against the wall. And on the other side of the frame of the panel, you see Luke's ship.
Uh-huh.
But this is more of an X-wing.
Right. So, no, I think this is just within the base.
You're right.
Yeah, so she is inside the base, but the spotlight is the door that's open to world.
This is the wall
right.
that she's up against, and this is just an X-wing in the foreground.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
Showing that she's in the hangar bay.
See, now, basically. For me, it would be more poetic if that was Luke's ship.
Oh.
And her thinking about Luke.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
So yeah, I misread the panel.
That's okay. That's okay. Well, I do have a runner-up for pure artistic beauty,
mm-hmm.
and that would be on page 16, when you have the panel of Baron Tagge's turbine destroyed with the purple-pink gas of Yavin. I just think it's really cool. It's really pretty.
And plus, look at the TIE fighter wings. They're being evaporated this explosion of the engine.
And this explosion is a Sabine-worthy explosion.
Oh, look at those colors.
Yeah.
Now, you know what? I'm going to pick another panel because my last one didn't work out.
Okay.
You go to a couple of panels before this.
Okay.
You'll see that reveal shot of the turbine engine.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, look at that.
Yeah.
That's just some beautiful Infantino artwork. And look deep in that cyclone whirlwind, you see a little tiny TIE fighter.
I know.
Great for scale.
Oh, yeah. Very good. Wow. Yeah, everyone's agreeing. Nice coloring in this issue, says Colossus Rex. Rex Racer says great artwork. Y'all should be friends. Look at all these Rexes. I love it. Oh, and Kevin. Hi, Kevin.
Hey, Kevin.
Yay.
Sarah, tell me what your most non-Star Wars moment or line of dialogue was from this issue.
Okay, so when R2 gets creamed at the, you know, on the planet, on the mission where Luke took him and R2 gets shot, and then the Rebel tech says to Luke, "With all the attacks, we're scraping the bottom for everything, Skywalker. There's some working R2 units that could use his parts." Oh. What?
Well, it's not too far from what that other engineer said in Star Wars. This R2 unit of yours looks beat up. Do you want a new one?
Not on your life.
Mm-mm. So I think they were playing off of that line.
Okay.
All right, for me, it comes on page 11, and don't make fun of me, but this is C-3PO, who is yelling at R2 for being blown up and emotionally tells him to call me a carbon-scored crybaby. I need to work on my 3PO.
Oh, right, because he wants him to talk in any way.
Yeah, you know when you're so mad at someone, you're angry.
Oh, yeah.
You're angry at them.
Mm-hmm.
But you take out the word crybaby, and all of a sudden, it's a Star Wars moment again. But call me a carbon-scored crybaby. I can't see. If Archie Goodwin had given this script to Anthony Daniels and said, "Can you read this?"
Mm-hmm.
Anthony would have quit Star Wars. He really would have. All right, now, Sarah, before we wrap things up, we have to read a couple of letters from the Star Words letter column.
Excellent!
Now, this is where readers can write in to the writers of the Star Wars comics and praise them or tell them what they're doing wrong or how they're mad at them.
Okay.
Sometimes a little bit of all the above.
All right, so do you want to read this first one here?
This first letter reads, "Dear Arch, have you gone crazy killing Solo? Get him back somehow, will you?"
Wow.
Mm-hmm. And this is from the issue where the wheel, they were in the wheel and they were all involved in the big game. And
oh, yes.
Chewie had to shoot Han.
Okay. Now, who is this from?
This is from Joe Kohler. He lives at 2963 East Covina, Mesa, Arizona, 85203.
And Marvel responds back, "Judging by the large number of complaints, we're beginning to wonder if there wasn't a colony of Corellians hiding somewhere here on Earth. Sorry, gang. We didn't mean to get anyone upset."
Joe is going to be really in for a rude awakening when he sees The Force Awakens.
Oh.
Mm-hmm. All right, now let's read this other one.
Okay.
"Dear Mr. Goodwin."
Oh, can I read it? Can I read it?
Okay, now this is from a woman who is referring to a previous letter where the editor got Mahdi and Tagge mixed up.
Oh, okay. "So, dear Mr. Goodwin, it was not Tagge who was humiliated by Vader. I went to the script to straighten out the confusion. It is definitely Mahdi who bears Vader's displeasure. I've enclosed a transcription of the scenes referred to. The only reason for bringing this up is typical fanish obsession with details and an interest in avoiding future confusion. Yours, Maggie Nowakowska."
Oh, nice. I would have butchered that. And where does Maggie live?
She lives at 717 Belmont East, number 202, Seattle, Washington, 98102.
All right, now...
What did Marvel say?
Marvel said, we use the novelization of Star Wars as a reference point since it's the printed version most people are familiar with. All right, I have a complaint with this one. Yeah. All right, now why would you use the novelization knowing how much things have changed since the novelization?
Yeah.
Actually, there should have been an update on the novelization because the novelization is based on a script right before the shooting script.
Okay.
So there's a lot of stuff.
That's different.
Like the Tashi station is still in there.
Right.
And I would say that most people are more familiar with the movies than the novelization.
Well, now, at this point, there's not VHS.
No, but Star Wars had been playing for a year and a half.
Right, but not everyone has the time to go out multiple weekends.
We were all kids. We saw it an infinite a number of times.
Okay.
And they could have just maybe had reached out since they got so many complaints about mixing up Mahdi and Tagge.
Yeah.
Maybe call over to Lucasfilm and say, hey, guys, can you clear this up?
Well, there
and apparently, Maggie Wakanowska.
No. Nowakowska.
Nowakowska. She had a copy of the script, which was, okay, The Art of Star Wars came out November 1st, 1979.
Okay.
This was the book that had the script in it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and this is May of 1979, so I'm not sure where she got a script.
Yeah, me either. Yeah, she says, I went to the script to straighten out the confusion. Yeah.
In that version, she continues, Tagge is on the receiving end of Vader's demonstration of the Force.
Huh.
So, Chris Alexander, are you still with us? You have a copy of the Star Wars novelization readily available.
My.
Look this up and take a screenshot, would you?
Yeah, he's got like a Star Wars library.
Yeah, or take a picture with your camera and post that, because I want to see that.
Yeah.
So that is why they mixed up Mahdi and Tagge and Mahdi, because they were referring to the novel.
Okay.
Yeah, they could have had the storybook. That didn't confuse them.
No.
There were so many different options.
What's the storybook?
This is the Star Wars storybook with R2 and 3PO on the cover. This is the reason why everyone thought the Tashi station scene was included in the Star Wars release.
Right.
Because we were so used to looking at this book, it just became embedded in our mind that this scene was part of the original Star Wars release.
Okay.
You know what? But now we have closure. Okay? That's all well and good. We can now move on with our lives.
Yes. We can now move on to the outro.
Skywalking through classic
Thanks, everyone, for joining us on
Classic Marvel Star Wars Comics,
where we just went through issue 26, Doom Mission. So we'll see everyone back for Return of the Hunter.
We want to thank Rob Dellinger for our main theme. Check out Rob at alpharhythmkings.com. And also, please check out all the rest of the shows on the Skywalking Network. Including Skywalking Through Neverland.
Talking Apes, which the next episode should be out next week, where we did an episode with Max Cervantes and Kevin Toft.
And also the Max Effects Podcast.
With Max Cervantes and Kevin Toft.
And you can find them all at skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
And you can look for a brand new show coming mid-October called
The Neverland Clubhouse. And another brand new podcast series or two coming in November. Exciting, you guys. And in fact, we just put out a newsletter to update everyone. So, So I'm going to put in the comments the link to be subscribed to our newsletter mailing list so that you guys can be up to date on everything happening on the Skywalking Network, including new podcast episodes, new podcasts, when we go live, and projects.
Oh, lots of interactive projects coming your way.
Yes. So please sign up to be on our mailing list. Now, if you are part of the Skywalking Force, our Patreon, we are starting to share some behind-the-scenes posts with our subscribers, like different iterations of a new podcast theme, like the Neverland Clubhouse theme that's going to be coming, or even some logo ideas. And you may even have the opportunity to vote on some things and help shape the Skywalking Network. So head to skywalkingforce.com and check out all the different levels available. And thank you to those of you who are already part of the Skywalking Force.
Now, Sarah, if people want to reach out to us on our social media platforms, where would they go?
They go to Skywalking Pod for Twitter and Instagram and TikTok. And you can also go to Facebook and search Skywalking Through Neverland to subscribe to our Facebook page and our Facebook group, which you can request to join and then answer those questions that pop up. You can also email us, share@skywalkingthroughneverland.com.
And you know what would be really great?
What?
If people went over there to Apple Podcasts or Stitcher and left us a review.
Aww.
Wouldn't that be so wicked awesome? Come on, spice sniffers, you can do it.
And then if you're listening to this in your podcatchers, we encourage you to watch when we record these classic Marvel Star Wars comics episodes live, because we do share the comic book pages as we talk about them and the story. It's really great. If you want to catch some of these episodes where we share those images, you can go to YouTube and search for classic Marvel Star Wars comics on our YouTube channel, and you'll be able to watch us there as well.
All right, now for classic Marvel Star Wars comics, this is Richard.
And this is Sarah.
Saying,
uh-oh.
You're a spice sniffer.
Now!
FTOOM!
Bloop! Vidow!
Vidow! Fradoop! The wheat frit! Alright, Chris Alexander just texted me.
It's gonna be right up here.
There we go. The Star Wars novelization, where it is Tagge. The Force, Tagge sneered. Don't try to frighten us with your sorcerer's ways, Lord Vader. When that was a line said by Monty.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.